The Achaemenid Empire had existed for over 200 years. Under the capable rule of Artaxerxes III, the empire had even made a resurgence. Its borders, and more importantly its influence, was restored across its vast frontiers. However, change was on the doorstep. The empire that had experienced thousands of cuts over its long life, but refused to bleed out, was about to hemorrhage. A perfect storm, at the most inopportune time for the Persians, was about to descend upon them. For those 200 plus years, the Achaemenid kings of kings and a stable of capable generals had protected the empire from both external and internal influences. Accounts as to Artaxerxes III's cause of death vary. Greek sources say it was a poisoning, and that he was assassinated by his own vizier, a court eunuch by the name of Bagoas. Bagoas was a crafty and cunning politician who had shielded himself from scrutiny through a series of carefully architected alliances. Just prior to the supposed assassination, he had allied himself with the Rhodian mercenary General Mentor, who had played a pivotal role in bringing Egypt back into the empire's fold. Another account, the cuneiform tablet found in an archaeological dig, cites natural causes for the death, but the truth likely lies somewhere in between. Bagoas likely had a hand, given his positioning at the time of these various supposed poisonings. We know that Artaxerxes' death came at the worst time for the empire. The empire needed Artaxerxes' strength and his ambition if it was to survive what was to come. Arses took the throne upon his father's death, and we know based on varied sources that Bagoas likely did have some involvement, and that if he didn't do the poisoning, he certainly had a vested interest in the outcome of that death. Bagoas had likely also murdered many of Arses' siblings and likely hoped to control Arses upon the throne to use him as a puppet. Upon taking the throne, the events were already beginning to spin at a pace that Arses could not have anticipated. He was approached by proxies of Philip II of Macedon, who demanded compensation from Arses for Artaxerxes III's assisting the town of Perinthus. Arses declined Philip, who then set an expedition of 10,000 Macedonian soldiers into Asia Minor in 336 BCE. This was occurring while Arses was also aware and trying to free himself from Bagoas' influence on him. He attempted to use Bagoas, his own personal MO of poisoning, but he failed miserably, and Bagoas returned the favor and instead poisoned him and most of his family. Bagoas then played a major role in placing a cousin of Arses, Artashata, on the throne. He was a champion in individual combat under Artaxerxes III's campaign against the Cadusi, where he was known as Codomannus. What he was not, however, was a trained leader of men or armies, and certainly not of empires. As with Arses, he immediately sought to distance himself from the influence of Bagoas upon taking the throne. He also adopted the royal name Darius III after his ascension. Bagoas, as he had done so many times before with the other Shahs, sought to remove Darius via poisoning. However, while Darius was naive to the ways of empire, he was not naive to individual politics or power plays. He was able to not only prevent Bagoas' poisoning attempt on him, but to then force Bagoas to drink the poison himself. This left Darius III on the throne by himself. As stated, he lacked all the traits of previous Shahs, and he was effectively rudderless and oarless on a throne that was quickly about to enter Whitewater Rapids. The empire of Darius quickly began to suffer under his ineptitude. The corruption, which had experienced a resurgence after the death of Artaxerxes III, was by now rampant, with each satrap looking after his own best interests. The Greek city-states, meanwhile, had increasingly turned towards Philip II and his promise to free the Persian grip on them and their lands. He had formed the League of Corinth, and the members shared an oath of mutual protection amongst themselves. The force of 10,000 Macedonians that Philip had sent to Asia to free Greeks living there from Achaemenid influence. They won several successes, but then Philip was assassinated in October of 336 at Egae, the ancient Macedonian capital. Pausanias of Orestes, the captain of his personal guard, was found to be the culprit, and during a marriage celebration of Philip's daughter by his fourth wife, he successfully killed Philip and tried to escape, but Philip's bodyguards caught him and immediately killed him. At the death of their king, Macedon mourned, but even as they mourned, his son, Alexander, would quickly pick up the mantle of leadership. When he was in his young teens, Alexander had led armies on his father's behalf. One such expedition was into southern Thrace to subdue revolts there. Alexander was said to even have saved his father's life during one such expedition. But upon his father's assassination at the young age of 20, he was proclaimed king of Macedon on the very same grounds of the celebration of marriage, while his father's body had not yet even turned fully cold. 336 BCE was the pivotal year that would signal cataclysmic change in the known world of both the Greeks and the Persians. Alexander, taking a page from the Persian Shahs, began his rule by purging those who could challenge his claim. He would kill all rivals, including his cousin, the former Amyntas IV, whom he had executed. Thebes, Athens, Thessaly, and many Thracian tribes north of Macedon revolted after news of Philip's death, but Alexander wasted no time in mustering 3,000 Macedonian cavalry and heading south towards Thessaly. He prompted their surrender and had their forces join his and continued his way south towards the Peloponnese, stopping only once he got to Thermopylae. Athens sued for peace. The others quickly followed. Alexander, using his father's style of troop formation and the Macedonian phalanx that he had been instrumental in creating to full effect. At the Battle of the Carts against the Thracians in 335 BCE, he managed to rout them in their entirety. In the spring of 334, Alexander, now confirmed as hegemon by the League of Corinth as his father was, invaded Asia Minor at the head of an army comprised of both Macedonian and Greek soldiers. This action would mark the beginning of the Wars of Alexander. Meanwhile, in Persia, it's been surmised that Darius faced the familiar action of satrapy revolt in where else but Egypt. In addition, there was a pretender on the throne of Babylon, long part of the Persian Empire. And Darius, who had received no training or tutoring to run an empire and certainly had no natural inclinations, likely felt extremely uneasy with all these events happening near the borders with Greece and Asia Minor. Darius's extreme mistrust of the current ruling elite, even the few who supported him, did the empire no favors. Alexander's army entered into Asia Minor and came to a stop at the river Granicus. It was a much smaller Persian army, and one that had leaders of not only differing strategic opinions, but ones with no real track record of fighting battles on this scale that were there to meet him. The exception was the Greek mercenary leader Memnon, who strongly urged the Persians to not fight a direct face-to-face battle with Alexander and his troops. Instead, he suggested they scorch the lands around Alexander, deprive him of food to sustain his mobile army. His tactics, while sound, were ignored as the satraps present wanted no part in destroying portions of their own lands. This, most scholars agree, was the pivotal battle that would decide the empire's fate. Memnon had been loyal to the Persians for most of his life. Being a military general, he knew Greek tactics better than anyone then in service to the empire. More importantly, he knew Alexander and his father better than anyone in the empire. He had been exiled for a time and fled to Macedon, where he met Philip II and a then young Alexander. It was stated that they had many lengthy conversations. Alexander showing interest in Persian tactics, and Memnon in turn able to get accurate measure of Philip as a leader and tactician, as well as Macedon's overall military capabilities. Before his death, it even sought to ally with Greek city-states like Athens, who had been preparing for possible revolt. As with Henry VII in England, Alexander benefited arguably more from his enemies' missteps than his military strategy, sound as it was. The Persians, in not unifying and following Memnon's lead, put their self-interests ahead of the empire. The Persian Empire was an empire built and sustained through cooperation. They didn't know it yet, but they were effectively handing it over to Alexander. It was Alexander who made the first move, sending one of his generals, Nicanor, and his cavalry, along with some Hippaspists, to attack the extreme left of the Persian line. As the Persian left flank weakened, Alexander called on the entirety of his right flank beyond Nicanor to concentrate on this now weakened portion of the Persian left. The Macedonians hit the Persians with such force, they were forced back towards higher, elevated grounds beside them. Unfortunately, this put them out of range of the Greek phalanx. Instead, they fell in behind Nicanor's cavalry. Alexander, who was already extremely visible with the colorful plumage of his helmet, was now in the fray, pushing his cerasas into the Persian troops. He would break several, having them quickly replaced after each break. The Persian commanders, who were nearby on seeing Alexander so close and relatively unprotected, attempted to attack him directly several times, at one time coming up directly behind him. It was only the quick reaction of one of his leaders, Cleitus the Black, who saved him. The Persians continued to fall back, and Alexander had his troops continue to push the Persians away from the shore of the river. After a short time, they were successful, and they broke through the Persian line near its center. Many Persians were killed as the Greeks continued their push, and many Persians fled. Soon, the Greek mercenaries supporting the Persians would be surrounded by their fellow countrymen under Alexander's control. Mercenary rules under the League of Corinth for these traitors was clear. Any Greek soldiers supporting enemy armies were viewed as traitors. And after a short battle, most were killed, and the rest shipped off to work labor in the Macedonian mines of their homeland's mountains. 2 years into their labor, Alexander, responding to the pleas of Athenian and other Greek city-state citizens, would end up freeing them. With the battle now won, Persia's western border lay ripped open before the Macedonian king. And Darius, now fully aware of the Greek victory, likely understood the urgency needed, as he was quick to build an army in 334 and early 333, with which he hoped to meet Alexander and defeat him. Alexander had the Persian capital of Sardis surrender shortly after his victory. He was able to deplete its treasury and continue south along the lands near the Ionian coast. As city after city fell, he would grant them autonomy within the framework of the lands he was expanding. The mountainous terrain of Lycia was next for Alexander's army, and then all the coastal cities of the south to better deprive the Persians of any landing spots. By the spring of 333, he had crossed the Taurus into Cilicia, but quickly fell ill. After a rest of several months, he began the march towards present-day Syria. This time, Darius was personally leading the Persian troops, and morale was likely high as he had managed to flank Alexander from the rear and cut off his vital supply line. Alexander, on hearing of Darius and his army, turned back towards Darius. The two sides would meet near the town of Issus. Darius, at the behest of his advisors, who felt victory was inevitable, massed his troops on the small adjoining coastal plain. Darius, as like many previous shahs, would once again fight the Greeks on terrain that favored the Greek enemy and mitigated the effectiveness of the fearsome Persian cavalry. And this ends the first part of the finale. So this is part 8. Part 2 of the finale, which is part 9, will be up next. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, please hit the like button. And if you haven't yet, but enjoy the content, please consider subscribing. We'd love to have you on board. As always, and until the next video, cheers.